yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome once again to the Story Behind the Story. I'm your host, Dr. A. Truat. You can call me true, but just don't call me false. Ha, ha, ha. Hey, folks. Hey, it's a weird Friday. Yeah, it's the Friday before All Hallows Eve. You know how that craziness goes. Plus, you know, the moon is, well, not only is it a moon crazy time, the word lunacy comes from, you know, the action of the moon on people's psyche, folks. That's reality.
Nothing I can do. I can't. We're literally nothing on my side. Okay.
We're having some background noise, guys. Hold on, please. We can hear you. Okay, folks. Golly, we have a great show lineup for you today. Let's just jump right into this, folks. I'm telling you, my interaction with Dr. Michael Nucitelli and his incredible guest, Dr. Vera, last week. I just want to again thank you for the comments, the questions. We've had all kinds of technical difficulties with Dr. Nucitelli's show last week. But let me just tell you, folks, Dr. Nucitelli, as we explained last week, is an incredible forensic psychologist. I mean, what that means, folks, he studies the human mind and what makes it tick. And we've had some great discussions. And let me tell you, if he was on the show tonight and to follow up on his interview of last week, the term crazy or lunacy, folks, in this society is pretty much a subjective thing. You see, if you step outside the box that the machine creates for your mind, you will quickly get a label. You will quickly be labeled by peers and other so-called scientists, the scientific community. You'll be labeled a little queer, a little bit lunatic, a little bit crazy. You know, you'll be dissed on. You'll be asked to shut your mouth or basically, even worse, be censored from even exercising your most basic freedom of speech, the most incredibly important gift you have to not only think your own thoughts, but to also, if you have a desire, to put those thoughts into words. That's called free speech, ladies and gentlemen, and it's a basic tenet of human rights and human freedom. So tonight on this show, we're going to have some free speech. We're going to have some free thinking here, ladies and gentlemen. I have two incredible guests. I have never met them before. I've never talked with them before until this show, but I guarantee you this will be incredibly mind-expanding and thought-promoting. You see, we have to think, folks. We have to have the freedom to think, to think outside of the proverbial box. And that's what we're going to be doing tonight in spades. Okay, hey, listen, folks. Mr. Mark Stangler will be my guest tonight. Mark is a radio talk show host on his own. I understand I was able to listen to a few of his programs just a short amount. I haven't had the time to really dig into it. And I can tell you this guy appears to me to be an incredibly free thinker, incredibly deep free thinker. That's important. We also have Miss Patricia Steer with us today. We're going to have an interaction with these folks. Because when I talk to you about the subject matter of the show tonight, I guarantee you there will be eyebrows raised. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, Dr. Ott has kind of, he's treading on the forbidden territory of lunacy. Yeah, I can hear it, folks. You know, been there, done that. Ladies and gentlemen, this show has been going, as I've said before, since the early 90s, we've started producing the story behind the story. I say we, my co-host, Mr. Warren Anderson, we actually were nominated for Peabody Awards, ladies and gentlemen, because you see, it's important to get people thinking, whether it's on this topic tonight or just any topic. Think deeply. And I want to just preface what the topic matter is today is how do we know anything is absolutely true and factual. We've been told things from infancy. We've been told in school, the world is this way, the world is that way, this way, that way. And literally, folks, if you look at it objectively, you must go back to the powers that be, a group of individuals known as the National Aeronautic and Space Association, NASA. That's really what makes it happen. Has anybody really gone into outer space themselves? I know I haven't. Okay, have you been able to go up in the upper atmosphere and look at the Earth from that vantage point, or have you just been shown pictures of that and told that's just the way it is? Folks, I need to tell you this, and I'll bring on Mark and Patricia, and we'll begin the show at that point. Back in 1991, I came across this most incredible story. It's one of the first broadcasts that I did, and story behind the story. It was a hard copy of a diary that was written, a diary entry by none other than Admiral Richard Byrd. Now, of course, the question has to be asked, is this legitimate? Is it genuine, or is it just a hoax, a fictional hoax being perpetrated? I followed this through in my research and to the point of being in contact with, yes, Admiral Byrd's wingman, co-pilot, so to speak. There was a radio operator, a pilot, and a co-pilot, and Dr. or Admiral Richard Byrd that went on this most incredible journey in the Arctic. And I tell you, folks, you talk about expanding your brain to think of something. This did it for me. I had absolutely no doubt this was a factual experience, and I've put that diary link. Sean has put that up on the chat room. You can see that. If you haven't been exposed to that, folks, this is. Oh my goodness! This gentleman was in his late 80s at this time, in the early 90s. He had not many years left to live. He knew that. But in the interest of national security, he was still not allowed by an oath he took not to discuss this topic on radio, public radio, or any other medium, whether it's newspaper or television. And I thought at that time, why? What's the reason behind keeping the story so secret? You know, and it goes back again to really the controllers that operate behind the scenes, the machine, as we like to call it, like we said in every show. Pink Floyd's incredible song that we started the program off, The Machine, pretty much sums it up. Without any further ado, let me bring on my special guests tonight. We have Mark and we have Patricia. Mark, are you with us? Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
You're coming through loud and clear, pushing 10. We have Patricia Steers as well. Patricia, how are you tonight?
I'm doing great. Am I coming in loud and clear as well, Dr. Ott?
You're doing wonderfully well. Thank you. Thank you both for coming on. And I got to tell you, Mark, thank you for your stand-in. I like your website. I've gone and read it. It's brought back a lot of deja vu, I must say, for what I went through in the early 90s. I tell you, when you start talking about subjects like this, it's so easy to be written off as a quack and lose credibility. It's just flat out part of our psyche. I mean, I listened to a statement that our fraudulent president, Barack Obama, said concerning arguments against global warming. It's, let's not be crazy like the Flat Earth Society people are. I mean, this is from, I mean, to talk about a fraud that shouldn't even be, you know, he's not legally allowed to be president, but yet he is. What a hoax perpetrated and continuing so. Okay, we won't go there, but Mark, welcome to the story behind the story, my friend.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Wow, there's so many things we can... let me just start with the basics with you, Mark. And Patricia, we want to keep you engaged with this. And we have Dominique with us, who's a pilot, folks. Dominique is my producer of the show, my main man. He really is. And Dominique brought this subject to me, oh, golly, quite a few months ago. And I did not. I have enough respect for Dominique and his intellect that this is something that you just don't dismiss offhanded. Dominique is a pilot, you know, ladies and gentlemen. He flies planes, and he has a unique perspective. So Dom is going to come up with his perspective on this as well. So, Mark, what in the world caused you to be such a proponent of what's now so derisively called the Flat Earth Society? Tell us about it.
Well, it was something that I didn't get into lightly by any stretch. It started last summer, back in late last summer of 2014, which was I had looked at a lot of different conspiracies and kind of gotten burned out on most of them. You know, if you're a conspiracy person, there's only so many you can go through. There's only so many books on the shelf. And I kind of bumped into this one on accident. You know, it was literally the last book on the shelf, and I refused to read it, like anybody. And I try to tell people, you can be the most open-minded conspiracy person in the world, but this one is the only one that people absolutely just, you know, they laugh, they roll their eyes, they ridicule it. And when I was looking at it last year, I glanced at a German guy who had mentioned in a video that, yeah, the flights in the Southern Hemisphere look wrong. I thought, okay, that's interesting. And then I had stumbled across Matt Boylan, his video on YouTube, and he had said that when he was in his 20s, he was recruited by NASA to do some photorealistic paintings, and that they told him during kind of a high-end party where he was at that, yeah, the world actually wasn't round, it was flat, and NASA's basically been hiding it this entire time. And he didn't believe it, of course. You know, being 25 at the time, he thought it was a complete joke. And everyone, I'm not kidding when I say this, everyone that looks at this should treat it like that right off the bat. You should not, in fact, I challenge anybody to really absorb it that quickly, with the exception of maybe Patricia here, but that's because she's so strange. But most people just brace against it. And even I couldn't figure out why. When I was first digging into it, the first time I was like clicking on some of these videos, I was physically embarrassed. I mean, I had the physical flushing and I was getting angry and I couldn't figure out why. And so I really tried to dig in and disprove this guy that said he worked for NASA. And I worked on it for a good 9 months. And every time it turned into like a Pandora's box and a brown paper wrapper, to where after about 9 months, the beginning of this year, February of 2015, I woke up in the middle of the night and I had it. Something in my head had clicked, and I had the whole thing in front of me. It was like, you know what? I'm changing sides. I'm not going to debunk this thing because it can't be debunked. And I consider myself a really good creative problem solver. And so I woke up, you know, real late in the night and sat down at the computer. I had the whole narrative in my head. And just started cranking out what is now called the Flat Earth Clues. And I said, you know, said to myself, I said, if I run into any clue as I'm making these, and I was making basically one a day for the first 8 days, if I run into anything that really doesn't jibe with me, that conflicts with the others, I'm just going to walk away from this thing. And they all seem to line up. And so I basically, the summary is, I kind of inadvertently put out a challenge to the internet, which was, how do you know it's a globe? How do you know that the globe has been in the corner of every classroom you've ever sat in? How do you know that's real? Do you know just because you equate it with things like gravity and fire and water, it's just a given in life? Or do you know because NASA told you? And if NASA told you, you're making a big leap of faith there because they're a military wing of the U.S. government. And so what the short version of this, and I'm sorry, I'm kind of rambling, is that let's say if they couldn't prove it was a globe until like the 1950s when rocket technology was advancing, if you couldn't prove it until then and you went up there and it wasn't quite exactly what it looked like, and by that I mean it just wasn't a globe, would you tell the public? And the more I looked into it, the more it became very apparent that No, you couldn't tell the public. It would disrupt so many different things, from social to economic to religion, that they just said, you know what, we're going to hold on this thing for as long as we can. And that was 60 years ago, and it's now seems to be falling apart, which is why the movement has gotten so big right now. And even though, like you were saying, it sounds ridiculous, and people that are out there, again, their first reaction is, why are we even talking about this? And I said the same thing, which is why I can't get mad at people that get mad at me. It's like, look, I was there. So anyway, that's where we are now.
Great, ex- great explanation, Mark. Thanks for that. But my questions to you, I guess, to start out the discussion is, why would they perpetrate such a massive disinformation campaign for so long? What's the rationale for it? What's the motivation for it in your mind?
What do they gain from it, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, think about it this way. If you're, and again, it wasn't like they perpetrated the hoax for 500 years. It seems that whoever built this place has kept that going. But when the Americans and the Russians figured it out, and I'm estimating around 1956, they had to look at the power structure that was in place, and they had to see what would change. And one of the biggest things that would change is it would lend credence, very, very strong credence, to intelligent design. More than anything, you're basically saying, oh, yeah, by the way, if it's not a globe, then it's probably some sort of dome structure. And if that's the case, you're probably looking at the handprint of God over there. Should we show that to the major religions, the ones that science has been beating up for centuries? That would, the paradigm shift in spirituality would be massive. You're basically looking at the five major religions that control 80% of the population, that is Hinduism, Judaism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity. You're looking at those five religions, you're basically saying, oh yeah, by the way, we were wrong, and all your texts, for better or worse, seem to be right. And you're sticking your chin out there if you're science. Forget about the economic side of it. Look at it this way. Imagine every university, and you know, you're well educated. Imagine every university in every country in the world, their astrophysics and astronomy departments get burned down overnight. And then the remaining physical sciences, like geology, hydrology, geography, archaeology, take your pick, they have to all be retooled to fit the new model. And that's just the education system. Economics, oh, I don't know. How about the $1 trillion fraud by NASA over the last six decades? The class action lawsuits by the subcontractors, and those subcontractors would take forever. The stock markets would be a mess. It'd be basically a soup sandwich for a long time, and they just don't want to deal with it. They'd rather deal with the status quo and say, you know what, let's not deal with it. We'll deal with that when we deal with it, but for now we're just going to leave it as is, leave everything the way we want it, and just hold on to it because it's only money. And so far it's worked, but it's running out of gas. The space program, they could only use smoke and mirrors for so long, and now it's starting to fall apart.
Well, good answer. That's kind of what the conclusion I came up with just in my limited study on this topic after discussing it with Dom months ago. I've interviewed a number of ex-Hollywood executives, okay, that worked deeply into in what the film industry describes as predictive programming, and he was this one gentleman. I go back to what he's continuously saying, that so much of what comes out of Hollywood is rooted in truth, but twisted. And the classic case in point with this topic is that Jim Carrey show, The Truman Show. Okay,
yeah.
Golly, are we really living in a Truman Show type of a bubble, ladies and gentlemen, where everything is manipulated and moved and basically, that we're just so backwards from what it reality is? Again, the question becomes, how do we know, without any shadow of a doubt, if you're from Missouri, go and show me. I'd like to go up in a rocket ship and see for myself, but man, I don't have that type of ability to do that. Neither does the vast majority of people listening to this show tonight. So I got to ask, and I want Patricia to weigh in here real quickly, and with this basically her same perspective of how she got involved in this line of thinking. But I need to kind of shall we say, focus on what can really happen to this world positively if we, if we go back to the original line of thinking that was for thousands of years, which is that a flat earth society. Remember when Columbus in the 15th century, 1492, he was convinced, he thought the world was a globe, he thought it was circular, but the general consensus of every learned man and woman was flat Earth, ladies and gentlemen. There was again, well, you sail the ocean, you fall off the shelf. It said that's not true. But where did we get the concept then of so-called flat Earth? You see, and looking back to civilizations like the Egyptians, I got to tell you, there's some things that I've come across in my study of ancient Egypt, and things that are so hidden. I think the ancient Egyptians knew full well we weren't living on a globe, okay? So if in fact, see, there's no such thing as evolution, folks. There just isn't. The civilization of ancient Egypt just appeared, boom, somehow, somewhere, fully technologically advanced. Very much so. It didn't evolve from stone men, cavemen. They came, and what's happened is a devolution. We've devolved into some pretty strange systems. And I want to get your your input here on where you came into this discussion.
Well, I've always been interested, not always, but ever since perhaps the late 80s into the 90s, into conspiracy sort of things. I used to be a radio talk show host and a DJ, small market stuff. And I kind of got interested in, you know, things like Art Bell and aliens and the face on Mars, sort of issues that Richard C. Hoagland, that piqued my curiosity. And then, you know, I did a talk show that was loosely based on that sort of thing and interviewed a couple of people that, including Richard C. Hoagland and Graham Hancock. And I was interested in that. But then 9/11 came along and 9/11 changed things for me. Because I didn't automatically right away see something was wrong. But later, upon investigation and watching some documentaries, I saw that what was presented to me and to all of us when it came to 9/11 wasn't the truth. So then I started a mission of truth seeking. And YouTube is perfect for that, as are podcasts and such. And just listening to as much as I could and watching as much as I could, I found out that the Apollo moon landings, that was a complete and utter hoax. Many fine documentaries on that. And I was looking at something along those lines when on YouTube a suggested video or something caught my eyes, and it was called Flat Earth Clues. So I thought, this looks interesting. It looks weird. Let's check it out. And immediately started listening. And that was Mark Sargent's work before I knew who Mark Sargent was. And literally time stood still. I went into a time warp or an alternate reality. And I didn't leave my house for what seemed like a couple of weeks in retrospect. I didn't really eat. I didn't really sleep. I just watched these Flat Earth Clues and then went down the rabbit hole, watching all sorts of other videos on Flat Earth, and just, you know, explored the pros and the cons and the debunking of Flat Earth. But Flat Earth almost immediately seemed to resonate with me, because there'd been so many things that I'd seen as feeling wrong, although I couldn't put a finger on it through life. And this sort of tied it all together. And I became a Flat Earther. It took me a while before I started speaking about it publicly. I kind of found out about it in March and didn't really speak out and start a YouTube channel till this past August of 2015. But it possessed me, and I still feel a frenzied possession that I need to find out as much as I can. And it's not a negative thing. You were saying about spinning it positively. It's not negative. Yes, we've been lied to by everybody all of our lives, and our grandparents and their grandparents. But it's positive, because we could maybe get away from the control system that we're under and start a whole new way of living.
Wow, that's incredible, Patricia. Yeah, that's when you start seeking truth, you can't just filter out what's popular or what's unpopular. You got to go for it all, or you go for nothing. You know, and that's my story too. My name is literally True. I've been kind of possessed with finding the truth on all things myself, and so. Yeah, I hear you. Boy, do I ever hear you, Patricia. Thanks for that. You know, looking at the realm of quantum physics, quantum mechanics, I think it's kind of interesting. when you talk about the concept of multiple dimensions, you know, you have in the apocryphal text that's not part of the Bible, but you have the so-called Book of Enoch, as it's called, the story of this ancient prophet Enoch going into different heavens or different dimensions. It's really is a linear plane. It's not global, okay? And that's a huge clue, Mark. I don't know if I haven't watched all of your 12 clues, but to me, if you look at quantum mechanics, quantum physics, it is a linear plane, which means basically it's got to be flat, not a sphere, in order to go into different realities of existence. Comments, Mark?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And in fact, it was something I delved into, but really didn't touch on in the clues, like the double slit experiment, for example. It really, even science, when they look at that and say, well, you know, nothing's real until it's actually observed by, you know, one of us, you know, a conscious being. Even that screamed to me that this whole system was mechanical. You know, there was so many mechanical processes built in, and really that's what the clues started doing. You know, once I gave people the overview and said, look, it's really possible you're living in a Truman show and that it's been hidden from your entire life. And then I started breaking it down into the mechanics of it, which was, look, everything can be faked if you have enough technology. And by that, I mean the jet stream up above, the underwater conveyor system down below, the magma system. The outer structure, you know, you put these negative responsive barriers on the outside, making the temperature colder and colder, and then reducing the oxygen level as you go higher and higher, to where 99.99% of the people are never going to reach it. In fact, we didn't even, I'll give you one here. It appeared that we didn't even have the ability to discover it until the internal combustion engine. Without that, and that was what? That took us, our civilization, 4,900 years before, you know, almost an entire civilization. We didn't have the ability to find it. And then once it was discovered, then it was hidden from us. But yeah, the mechanics involved in this thing are staggering. And it only works. Everything seems to work better on a flat plane, which is what I was really getting into with the clues. Every system, everything from the continent layout to the oceans to the outer ring with Antarctica, it's amazing how well designed and how well crafted it is and designed really to keep us acting in a natural state. It's a combination of I call it, like, you know, either a wildlife reserve or a school system or an entertainment system. But either way, the whole point is we're never supposed to find the edge. They hide the fence. They hide the bars, if you think it's a prison planet, but it's amazing piece of work.
I tell you, yeah, and I want to bring Dom in to get his perspective here real quick. But I want to tell you what happened to me in the early '90s, in this interview I conducted with Admiral Byrd's wingman. I mean, this guy had absolutely no reason to mislead me. And he basically would just—he didn't want to give his own perspective. He just basically read the diary that I had. And it was a handwritten Admiral Byrd's handwriting, right? And he just nodded and he shed a tear. Frankly, he said, "Yes, all I can comment on is that is true, but I can't." He won't say any more, and he definitely wouldn't come on the radio show for whatever reason. Then I began to wonder why. You know, that's an incredible story, folks, about Admiral Byrd's Arctic expedition up towards to find the North Pole. What he discovered up there will blow your mind, folks, absolutely. Then you go down, and then you follow through in his Antarctic expedition. You know, this is right at the tail end of World War II had just concluded, right? The Nazis had set up a base in Antarctica. This was a huge, huge expedition that was almost as big as the D-Day invasion. I mean, folks, people don't even realize how big this was at the tail end of World War II. What happened there, again, was a conspiracy of silence, ladies and gentlemen. There was indeed, they did basically hit the fence. I'm telling you, as you really go and dig deep in that Antarctic expedition, there was some incredible anomalies that happened in the field of vision, in the field of radio transmissions, and the best way to describe it it doesn't make sense unless you look at it from the flat Earth's perspective. Then it starts to make sense. Mark, are you aware of that situation?
Yes, yes. The Admiral Byrd thing was really what turned me to... It really spun me completely around into the flat Earth. There was nothing left I could hold on to for me, which was people, yeah, like you were mentioning, people remember Admiral Byrd for the North Pole expedition, the one he did in 1926, and where he flew over the North Pole and supposedly went into the hollow Earth opening. But what was strange was he never went back to the North Pole again. You would have thought with the diary and everything, that's what he would have kept exploring. But no, from 1928 all the way until his death in 1957, he just kept going back to Antarctica. And he was looking for something. Basically, whoever sent him on point, for those of you who don't know who Admiral Byrd is, you know, he was the probably the most famous United States naval officer in history. The youngest admiral ever, made admiral at 41. And he was also an aviator and one of our greatest explorers of all time. And he goes down there, and someone was sending him on point. That much is easy. From 1928 up until 1956, that's pushing 30 years. He's looking for something down in Antarctica, he and his teams. And, yeah, Operation High Jump, which you were mentioning, which was 1946, he took a break during World War II. The only people that were doing work down in Antarctica, interesting enough, were the Nazis. What they did down there, what we rooted out with Operation High Jump in 1946, no one's going to know. And people, yes, he sent down a massive force, a full-blown carrier group, thousands of men, for some sort of what they call a peaceful expedition down in 1946 called Operation High Jump. Now, what happened during that time, we're never going to really know. But what we do know is that it was taken care of, because he comes on television in 1954 on a CBS show called The Long Jeans Chronoscope.
Right.
Great show. Sponsored by a famous watch company, if I'm not mistaken. And he comes on the show, and he basically he's just lining up. He's baiting all the corporations. He's saying, look, there's an entire mountain range made of coal. There's oil. There's minerals. There's uranium. There's at least 8 or 9 countries already on the ice, and everyone's kind of jockeying around and seeing how they're going to carve this thing up. He's saying this whole thing's made out of money. And he goes, yeah, we're going to go back down for our expedition in Operation Deep Freeze. We're getting a base camp ready. We're going to go. They go, and then it's just radio silence from that point forward. Everyone leaves the ice at the same time. And we're talking about big countries, people that needed the resources, like Great Britain and Russia, not to mention Argentina, New Zealand, Australia, Chile. They're all down there, and they all left the ice at the same time. And immediately, they formed a treaty, and they ended up signing it in 1959, which is a whole other thing. But in 1959, they signed the Antarctic Treaty, which is still in effect today, that says it's an ironclad treaty. No corporation from any country in the world can ever go down there to do anything, ever. And I'm reading through this stuff, and this is public information. This isn't secret information. You can look it up on Wiki. Nobody's questioned it. The treaty is still in effect today. In fact, there's an environmental treaty on top of that treaty. But it's true, and it goes against everything that we know, especially in America. You know, it's all about greed and money and power here. And it goes against everything we know here. We are raised on greed and money. And you're telling me that corporations can do anything they want here, especially the oil companies with unlimited financial backing. Not only can they not go down there, they can't even talk about going down there. So it's like, okay, why would you lock everybody off Antarctica? There's no cover story that you can come up with for that. No, it's that big. It's so big that it's even beyond money. And that shows you the scope of this thing, where they don't want even corporations to get a foothold there because it'd be just a pain down the road, you know, like a stray helicopter, a stray survey plane. Take your pick. They're just not going to deal with it. They say, you know what, we're just going to lock it up. And they created the Antarctic Defense Force, multinational navy, state-of-the-art technology, patrols the coastline. Nobody comes in and out without expressed written consent from multiple governments.
Isn't that just convenient? And now, listen, they called it Operation High Jump. Operation High Jump. What happens when you high jump, folks? You have to jump over a set bar, don't you? You're exploring again what happens when you go over a boundary. Now, folks, my interview with this pilot stunned me because he confirmed what happened in the Arctic. He also confirmed the Antarctic story, and he said, listen, he says, true, you don't want to know what happens when you go across this particular mountain range at the end of the Earth. He called it the end of the Earth. The end of the Earth is what he said to me in this interview in 1991. Okay, I said, is that a colloquialism? Is it a euphemism? He said, he just laughed. He says, no, I'm talking literally. That's all I'm going to say about it. And then I said, well, tell me, is it? He says, no. There were planes that just kind of went interdimensional. When you pass a certain barrier, you go into a different dimension of space and time. That's all he would discuss. That's all he would say. The end of the Earth, end of discussion. I can't talk anymore about it. Thanks for the talk, for your time. So Mark K, you're right on it, man. You're right on it. What can I say? Patricia, what do you think?
I just think the whole subject is endlessly fascinating. And it applies, you know, we can talk about things with Admiral Byrd and Operation High Jump and how Russia and the United States were kind of in on it. But we can bring that into present day, where Russia's got a space program going now. So does China, so do other countries. And they're all doing what we're doing. And it's like they're not our enemies, at least when it comes to what's going on in quote-unquote space.
Well said. Hey, let's bring Dominic in. Dominic, you know, like I said, I really do honor and respect you and your intellect. You know, you're a very smart man. You're much more advanced than I am in technology, for heaven's sakes. And that's what you do there in Silicon Valley. Dominic, what's your perspective on this as a pilot?
Well, true, I'm not as educated as you. I only have 2 master's degrees and a half of a PhD I never finished. So, but yeah, I'm technologically oriented, technically oriented. I have a very good mathematical and physics background. And I've been flying planes for like 30 years, both small planes and sail planes, high-performance gliders, things like that. And basically, I'm a little bit like Patricia. I discovered the topic earlier in the year. So I've been exploring it for several months, and I got the virus. As soon as I started learning, and Mark, it's not because he's here, but his clues were a very good path to a fast track to basically learn the patterns of what has been hidden from us. So, and from a pilot perspective, I mean, I've flown very high. I've flown with a 360-degree canopy around me, and I don't see any curvature on the Earth. If you own a glider with a full 360-degree view, which is not a round window like you have on a jetliner, because the round window on a jetliner will give you a perspective that's a little bit different than as you can imagine. It's all flat. There's no curvature anywhere. Besides that, there's a lot of experiments with high altitude balloons, even rockets that have been launched that show a camera without a fish eye will not show any curvature. So I mean that's kind of a summary of how I got here. But if you have any other specific question, I can tell you more about how planes fly and why pilots never see a curvature either, and they are not aware that the Earth is flat.
Well, you know, when I discuss this with intellectuals, so-called, you know, just to kind of give their take on it, after the rolling of the eyes and the really, are you willing to discuss this? They always come back to me and says, well, the bottom line, Drew, the sun sets in the west, it rises in the east, it comes up. If I take a plane and gas it up, I'll fly on a longitudinal latitudinal line, and I'll go west, and I'll eventually come east, and I'll circumnavigate the globe. End of story. I says, have you ever done that? Seriously, have you ever circumnavigated the globe? Of course not, but I could do that. See, this is, again, I says, but that goes back to what we've been, and I'm just playing devil's advocate here. You know, I understand what you're saying. The sun goes down, it comes up again, and there's a movement, you know, of the suns to the seasons. All this is, of course, self-evident. So I got to ask Mark, what about that argument? What's your response to that?
I'm sorry, the about the seasons?
Yeah,
I mean, the circumnavigation of the globe. Oh, I can give you a quick answer. True. I mean, you can circumnavigate the globe for sure, but if you think of a round table in front of you, if you draw a circle in the middle of the table, you can do the circumnavigation of the table on a flat disk. It's the same story.
Exactly true. You know, like on a dinner plate, if you just run a circle around a dinner plate, yeah, you're circumnavigating it. No question. And since the world we live in is so big, and you know, it takes a long, long time, and you would never notice it. You're making a really slow left-hand turn or a really slow right-hand turn, and the compass is going to work. A compass is going to work perfectly because the North Pole is in the dead center of the round disc. So it's still going to act like it would on a globe. You're not going to know any different. So again, it goes into the premise that I put forward, which is this place was designed in some ways to be pretending to be a globe. That's part of it. But that pretending, that illusion of the globe only holds so far as the civilization's technology. Once the technology, once the detection technology reaches a certain level, it all starts to break apart, and rather quickly, I might add.
Now we're getting into some juicy meat of the subject. I gotta tell you.
Well, true. Let me give you a very simple example. If the Earth is a globe and it's rotating at whatever, 1,000 miles per hour, the equator, like we're all being told, if you just take a helicopter, you raise yourself at 10,000 feet and you stay where you are, the Earth will be moving and you will find yourself 1,000 miles from, 1 hour later, 1,000 miles from where you took off. Isn't that the truth?
Yeah,
it should be like that.
I'll give you one more, and that is the one that people gravitate to the most happens to be the curve. Even though it's not one that I touched on in the clues, it seems to be the easiest pit for people to understand, and that is, you know, the Earth has to curve out over a certain distance. And if you believe what science says, then it's 8 inches per mile squared, which is 8 inches times every mile out times itself. So if it's 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4, times 8 inches, which is 32. But it keeps getting bigger. So 3 miles would be 3 times 3 is 9, times 8 is 72. Because it gets more and more exaggerated because as you go, if it is a sphere, eventually it's going to drop off vertical. So it's got to get more and more exaggerated. So at 50 miles, for example, like the Chicago skyline in the distance, you should not be able to see it from the other side of the lake, because 50 miles is almost 1,700 feet. And there's no building even close in Chicago that's 1,700 feet high. And that even at that point, you'd only be able to see the top. And yet we see what they say, oh, no, it's an illusion, even though it's the full-blown skyline. Everything's lit up. You can see it anytime during the day, but even at night. And we're going to check to see if we can see it with night vision, because that doesn't tell a lie either. Or I'll even go out even further, which is I had a guest on my show, a United States Navy missile instructor. He comes on and says, look, we're using tools the average person can't use. We can throw a 2-inch beam radar at about 60 miles. And we can paint a target at 60 miles that's just barely above the water. That is not possible. At 60 miles, that should be 2,000+ feet below the curvature of the Earth. And it makes it.
Wow, that's awesome. That's great. Yeah, and what can I say? Now I gotta have Patricia jump in here too a little bit on this. You mentioned, Mark, about the origins of creation as far as the flat Earth is concerned. How does how is that? You said there was a fingerprint of a creator that's more evident this way. Can you elaborate on that? What do you mean by that?
Sure, sure. If the globe is rather ambiguous, meaning, yes, there's all sorts of faiths and religions out there, but there's nothing, everyone, all the religions of the world have been looking for a mystical, magical artifact, be it the Holy Grail, the Ark of the Covenant, the Spirit of Destiny, just take your pick, right? But no one's actually found one. They've all been looking for it because all religions want to be able to point to something and say, you know what, this vindicates, this justifies all our faiths, all our written work. And up until now, it hasn't existed. If it's not a globe, if it is an enclosed system with some sort of firmament, let's take it out of Genesis, for example, if it's some sort of firmament, a dome, a barrier that's, you know, covering us entirely, well, then that barrier has edges. And if that barrier has edges, that means you should be able to walk right up to it and look at it. And if it's a barrier with edges, that means it was built by somebody. Am I saying it's the divine? Yeah, well, a lot of people would. Is it an advanced technology? Did God subcontract the work out? We don't know, but it's a higher civilization than us, and they're way better at doing, you know, what we're doing right now. So if that's the case, the religious world would change overnight. They would immediately be thrown a whole bunch of voltage through the spiritual world. Everyone would, I mean, there would be churches that would dedicate their lives. People would sell their homes to pay for a trip to go see the edge of this thing, if that was possible. And I think it's a very exciting time, potentially, that we're on the cusp of.
Well, you look at the continent of Antarctica, which we're told is a continent, but that, you know, and even look at a globe, okay, look at the, you know, the what they're telling it is, the edge of the bottom of the edge of the Earth is the Antarctica. I mean, it's just, it's all the way around, isn't it?
Well, yeah, the Antarctic continent is really, really different, and that is what happens is Antarctica isn't – what science says is Antarctica now is a kind of an island-type continent a little bigger than Australia. But in reality, that can't exist on a flat plane. All the other continents, they exist just fine. Yeah, the distances are a little different. The scale is off. But Antarctica in a full-blown flat map becomes stretched. What happens is Antarctica isn't actually just, in fact, it becomes the opposite of an island continent. It becomes stretched all the way around the outside, like a giant ring of frozen continent. And that makes sense because Antarctica as a continent is really unique when it comes to its physical characteristics. Look at what we know about it. You get out there, one, it's extremely cold on all edges. Once you get up to, still there?
Yes.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Once you get out to it, the coastline goes about, the edge of the beach goes about 150, 200 feet straight up all the way around. And then once you get on top of that, the continent slopes up really, really fast to about 10,000 feet and plateaus. The bulk of it is at least 2 miles high. There's no indigenous plant life, no indigenous animal life, no indigenous or ancient populations, anything like that. It is an amazing continent that acts as a natural barrier, and that is what is being hidden from us.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to see if you got that.
Yeah.
That's what my this guy interviewed explained. It and then when you know his job was to basically, you know, there was a group of it was like an aircraft carrier group, right? They flew along the very edges, and some of them penetrated, and they did lose planes. Okay. It was lost.
Yeah.
Top secret. I mean, this is classified above top secret. Yeah. Wow. Why?
Do you think that they lost planes because they went out of sort of the comfort zone that they were used to flying in, or it was environmental issues, conditions because of the cold?
He didn't elaborate on that, Patricia. My conjecture is lost means lost, whether they basically lost communication, they just couldn't come back in. There was a certain perimeter that they couldn't go past, or they would. It's like the almost like the Bermuda Triangle type of things. That's what I got out of the interview.
They also could have been taken out. That's another idea. What do you think, Mark?
Yeah, absolutely possible. The Antarctic, the secret that is Antarctica is one of, if not one of the best kept secrets of our modern times, which is the sweeping strokes that happened down there after 1956 were amazing to watch, and yet it was kind of put out of sight, out of mind. So yeah, all the major expeditions left. The Antarctic Treaty was put in place in 1956. The environmental treaties were put in much, much later. Yeah, you can, but they still let people go there. So you can still, it's not like, because they can't seal it off entirely. So if you want to go to Antarctica, yeah, you can spend the $10,000, $12,000 and you can go to the outer islands. And if you're lucky, maybe you can get a government employee to take you to where they say the exact South Pole is, but it isn't. But anything past that, is completely, if they don't say it's off limits, because they can't say it's off limits. They can't put a fence up saying it's a forbidden zone. They just don't let you go there. And, you know, it's worked very, very well over these years. It's been fascinating to watch.
And then they have things like Prince Harry, you know, walking across it in a group setting to show, yes, I mean, look how hale and hearty he is, but also to show, look, we can be in Antarctica. It's kind of a sort of programming us to believe that we are allowed to go there, and it's just fine. Anybody can go as long as they've got the money.
Yeah, but at the same time, they shut off all commercial flights, so no commercial flights fly over Antarctica anymore. Yeah, you can skirt sort of the edge, maybe, if you're lucky on a commercial flight, but and that's been that way for a long time. When you look up the forums line, they say, oh, because it's too cold. Really? That's the answer to commercial flights? You can't fly over because it's too cold?
Come too on. Cold. I mean, how cold is it at 30,000 feet? I mean,
exactly.
Yeah, the window of the plane, when you touch it, your hand is cold sometimes if you're up high. So that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Wow, so, incredible. Yeah, you know, you look at all the evidence, all of the clues, as you call them, Mark. You know, you got to scratch your head and say, something's, it doesn't pass the sniff test. It really doesn't. And and so the question then becomes, how programmed are we as a society to look at this with such derision and such mocking scoff and scorn, just to even talk about the subject? That's got to tell you something too, I submit.
It was amazing to me when I looked at it how easy it was to condition us, because the thing that Patricia pointed out to me several times is, really, you know, it wasn't anything complex. It was just putting the globe in the classroom. That was probably the most effective way of doing anything. It's always the simple stuff. You put a globe in a first grade classroom. You don't even have to tell the kids, you know, unless they ask, well, what's this? Oh, it's where you live. And then it sits there until you go through high school. If you go through college, you know, and get your master's or your PhD, well, then you're really in trouble, because, you know, then you get a whole more education. Oh, we're going to break.
Yeah, we are. Oh, golly, ladies and gentlemen, what a discussion. The first hour is flying by. Mark Sargent is my guest. Patricia Steele here is awesome. We'll be back with more. Why? Wild and crazy lunacy, folks. Really? Welcome to the machine, ladies and gentlemen. Machinations are all about what's put into your brain as to what you believe. As a man or a woman believeth, so is he or she. Ladies and gentlemen, I you know, at the conspiracy conference in San Jose a couple years back, I was able to actually meet Dominique for the first time. I talked to him on the phone a number of times. He listened into my radio show broadcasts over the years and kind of was a fan of some sorts. And that was nice to meet Dom and to get his help in a number of issues and to meet him. But I gave a presentation back then about the origins, you see, of weather modification. Because, you see, this is, believe me, when I bounced my information off of some very high-level individuals in Washington, D.C., who I trust explicitly, and they were like, yeah, you know, you're right on point, but again, it's not that, you know, that climate change is not happening, because it is, ladies and gentlemen. What I'm saying is it's being manipulated. It's being driven by technology, not by greenhouse gases, et cetera, et cetera. But my presentation was simply entitled Weather or Not. And a key part of understanding who is doing the weather manipulation, it helps you to explain the why of it. And it goes back into the four-letter acronym NASA again. So I, you know, the experimentations that have been done since NASA's existence are stunning. Okay, Jack Parsons and that group of individuals, folks. Jack Parsons is an absolute, I should say was, an absolute practicing Satanist, ladies and gentlemen. There's no doubt about it. Absolutely in the mold of Aleister Crowley and that group. I mean, that's just a reality. The experimentations included, yes, nuclear explosions in the upper atmosphere, folks. We're talking about trillions of copper needles spread out throughout the upper atmosphere. For what reason? Are they trying to find the upper limits of a dome structure, perhaps? But folks, what you have to realize about NASA and what makes them operate is where they began in the very under Jack Parsons and the whole group. Folks, there was a very select group of elite individuals who met in Maine, the state of Maine, and the Bush compound area of Kennebunkport, and they absolutely conducted a seance. And in that seance, they were contacted by a group of spiritual entities. I will say entities. Folks, they're not angels, okay? These entities were nine individuals that came and basically gave marching orders to NASA to produce what they're doing now. I'm telling you, when you look at what Mark is talking about here, what Patricia's been talking about in the first hour, okay, you're talking about a specific agenda, a very dark, occultic agenda. Okay, so when Mark explains what we believe in mass worldwide consciousness about being on a globe, you know, you really got to trace that back to, more than anything else, to NASA and that group of elitists behind it for a very specific agenda. So I want to just bring that out about Jack Parsons, NASA, Jet Propulsion Labs. I want to get Mark and Patricia's take on this. Mark, what do you think about that part of the story?
It's very, very interesting and doesn't necessarily surprise me, because NASA's entire inception, and for people, it's really tough. This is a tough one for people to get their heads around. NASA never did – it's not that they faked some of it. They faked all of it, and part of it could have very well been for ritualistic reasons, because they – when they were founded in 1958, they were founded with the entire purpose of hiding – where we are now. You know, they were the layer. They were the ones that hid the structure. They were founded, which was really interesting, at what you were talking about, the high altitude nuclear explosions. They were founded during that process. So when the high altitude testing started in 1958, after like the third shot, that's when NASA was created. And we all know, you know, they were created literally on the backs, on the ashes, not even cold ashes of the Nazi war machine, with Wernher von Braun, who also an enigma. If you want to look up a neat little tidbit on him, look up the fact that on his headstone, which is very, very modest, he's got a Bible verse on there that's Psalms 19:1, which basically says, depending on the translation you look at, and in the firmament shows his works. You know, why would he say this on his headstone? The founder of, you know, the NASA, more or less, you know, the guy that basically helped the rocket program become what it was. Fascinating stuff. But yeah, NASA created in 1958, and you know, during the high altitude testing And the high altitude testing worked hand in hand with them from 1958 until 1962. And with the Russians and us, they were both doing it at the same time. But yeah, sorry, get back to the point. The rituals involved in NASA, yes, symbolism is all over the place with them. Every mission, every name of every program, every missile package, the numbers, the numerology is everywhere. And it's been hidden in plain sight this entire time.
The Apollo logo has three stars of the belt of Orion on it, which is Osiris. I mean, you can look at all of their logos of the different missions, and they all have sort of occult aspects to them. And it just looks like interesting designs until you look closer.
Yeah. And what she said, and that all astronauts, regardless of where they were before they joined the program, were required to become rather high-level Masons before they got into it. Which why would that be a requirement of being an astronaut? Why would that have anything to do with it? It's fascinating. All the different ritual aspects and symbolism that is tied to NASA.
Well, take a look at the United Nations logo itself. You've got a flat Earth logo. I mean, come on. And you break it down into quadrants. You've got eight bisects and count the spheres up or count the segments up. And lo and behold, there's 33.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Same level as a Masonic Olor. Is that just coincidence that the way they have that logo is exactly the way it could lay out on a flat Earth dome structure?
No, there's no coincidence. The saying is, and I've said this before, and that is, I believe in coincidences. I've just never seen one. Not like this. The flag, the United Nations flag, for those of you who don't know exactly what he's talking about, is that the United Nations flag, which was designed in 1946, same year as Operation High Jump, has the exact same layout of the flat Earth map with one exception. And that exception is that there's no Antarctica on the UN flag, which is fascinating because it's a giant continent. It's bigger than Australia, but it's not symbolized anywhere on the flag unless you count the kind of Greco-Roman wreaths that border on the outside. But if you look on Wikipedia, you look in articles, it's not implied anywhere. It's not that they say, oh yeah, the wreaths are Antarctica. They just don't talk about it. They do not mention it anywhere. It's like, why not? Why wouldn't you mention it? Or better yet, why use that design? Why not use something else? You knew that Antarctica was down there. So the UN flag is the same as the flat Earth map, which is the same as the azimuthal equidistant map that the United States government uses in their catalog. And I'll throw one more wrinkle in there, and that is that flag, that map, that projection, all those things, the entire concept was designed by a Persian scientist back in 1000 AD. What, and you're thinking, why does this have anything to – how is this connected in any way? And NASA knows, if you believe in the rituals, because NASA named a moon crater after this guy. His name's Al Biruni. Look him up. A-L-B-I-R-I-N-I. Or, I'm sorry, B-I-R-U-N-I, Biruni.
Well, another funny thing about the laurel wreath symbology that's on the UN map that's sort of representing Antarctica is in Greek mythology, Apollo is represented wearing a laurel wreath on his head, all tied back in with the Apollo missions.
Nice. Good one.
Mark, since you were talking about the map, there was an incident about 2 to 3 weeks ago with an intercontinental flight going from southeastern Asia up to like Chicago. And for some reason, there was a woman who gave birth to a baby during the flight, and they had to make an emergency landing. Can you tell me where that landing happened and what do you think?
Oh, yeah. That was really interesting. The flat Earth movement really jumped all over it, which was... We've always known, well, the flat Earth people know that the flights in the southern hemisphere are all wrong, completely wrong. And even when they cross over into the northern hemisphere, they're off somewhat. Because on a flat Earth map, the distances are exaggerated when you get past the equator. And if it's flat, there are certain routes that don't bow over like they do in a globe. They're straight shots. So this woman was leaving, I believe her initial destination was she was going from Bali past Hawaii to Los Angeles or something along those lines.
No, it was going further to Chicago, I think.
Okay, so eventually to Chicago. But what happened was during the flight, you know, there was complications and they had to get her to a hospital as quick as they could. So you would have thought, because it was about 6 hours into the flight, it was pretty close to Hawaii and there's plenty of hospitals on there. They would have just continued the extra couple hours and gone to Hawaii. But they went almost due north. I mean, I'd like to say it was like north by northeast, but it was really almost north, all the way to Anchorage, Alaska. And it didn't make any sense, right? Because, and they didn't really talk about it from a weird standpoint on the major media, you know, saying, oh, you know, it was just one of those happy feel-good stories. You know, a woman has emergency landing in Anchorage, Alaska, and has the baby. But the flat earth people looking at us like, wait, it doesn't make sense. Why would that flight just go all the way up to Alaska? But when you look at it on a flat map, it's a straight shot. Exactly where you thought it would be, because on a flat map they were going past Alaska anyway, so it was literally on the way. But pilots, you know, they don't pay any attention to that stuff. They just, you know, go to where the GPS tells them to.
Well, that's funny, right? Because you know, as I went over to the Middle East on a flight last February, and we took off from LAX, and then we followed. You know, they had those inline, you know, online simulators. You think you just go straight across the continent of North America to the Atlantic Ocean over to Istanbul, Turkey. Mm-hmm. No, we went clear up over Alaska that way. It didn't. Yeah. I thought that was strange myself.
Yeah, the flights in the Northern Hemisphere, and you can look at, anyone's listening, you can look on this on Flat Earth Clues, but the flights on compared on the globe versus a flat map are way, way different. They do not make sense until you put them on a flat map. The routes, the connections, the Southern Hemisphere is the most obvious. And by that, I mean any flight that's going from South America to any flight near Australia should be just a straight shot across the South Pacific Ocean, but it's not. Right. I mean, it should be just a 12-hour flight. Why is it going to Dubai? Why is it connecting through San Francisco or Los Angeles or Dallas? None of these things should be happening. But on a flat map, these really exaggerated arcs become shallow dog legs, and in some case become a perfect straight line. And it's fascinating. The pilot I was talking to, the flight instructor I interviewed just the other day, because I asked him, I go, how do all the pilots miss this? He goes, you know what? We're so busy doing everything else that we just didn't pay attention to it. And since the plane got from point A to point B, no one cared. No one actually gave it a second glance. You know, fuel consumption, routes, you know, they're all trained to do a lot of different things, but it's been hidden in plain sight our entire time.
Well, Mark, the flight routes are given to the pilots on commercial airlines. They're given to the pilots by the airliner, by the airline company. They have a chief pilot that works on the routes for every flight, every route they take. And the pilots have no decision. They just follow the instruments from point A to point B to point C to point D to point E to the final destination. So they just keep hopping, and they don't have any perspective on the overall picture of where they are going, as long as they land at the final destination.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And honestly, and I talked about this in one of the clues, and I'm not going to pick on pilots too much, but even because, you know, they've got their jobs, their careers to think about. But even if they made that huge leap of faith, you know, it's like, wait, this map doesn't seem right. This route seems wrong. Even if they made the leap of faith and said, you know what, I think the map's wrong and the map looks a lot flatter than it does round, who are they going to go to? Who are you going to go to your supervisor? You're going to go to the airline? You're going to call the FAA? Who are you going to call to talk about this? You can't. You can't. I joked. I said, you might as well tell them you were chased by a spaceship the entire flight. That would actually be easier for them to swallow than what you're telling them. And yeah, it's an interesting. Plus the GPS system, which was designed by the U.S. military, the DOD, Department of Defense. It's a completely militarized system. And it's, you know, if people wanted all the details on that, listen to the flight instructor interview I did. It's fascinating. There's gaps in it, huge, massive gaps, not only in the oceans, but domestically. Over land, there shouldn't be gaps. It's supposedly a 24 satellite global positioning system. Why are there dead zones? Huge dead zones. This is an American system. We don't build anything small. We blanket coverage everything. You can't tell me that there's flaws. There's black spots on the map.
Oh, well, the other reason why the pilots don't see the curvature of the Earth is because they fly with a barometric pressure. The altitude is controlled by barometric pressure. They just stay at a constant, basically a constant distance from the ground in terms of altitude. So they just stay at a constant distance. Doesn't matter whether there's mountains or no mountains. They use by, they fly by barometric pressure. And for the airliners, the GPS is only a secondary or tertiary system. The primary system is in inertial navigation. So it's done with gyroscopes, and that's the primary system they use for intercontinental routes over the oceans.
And a challenge to anyone out there, because, you know, I hear this from a lot of people that initially say, well, you know, I've flown an airplane. I've looked out the window. I've seen a curve. I say, really? Really? You've seen a curve? Fine. Take your camera phone out. Take a picture of it. Take it home. Put it on your laptop. Hold up a straight edge or a ruler or a piece of paper, whatever you want to it. Tell me the curve's still there. You want to see the curve. That's the difference. No one, and I've been doing this now, what, only 8 months, but that's eight pretty solid months of doing this. No one has emailed me a picture of any airplane. They've taken the picture out the window, and it's a curve. And I think it's because, you know, you'd think they'd send me pictures and say, well, it was flat. No, it freaks them out. And then they don't know what to do, and then they become a flat earther, like Patricia.
Well, then there's the things like the Red Bull jump, which they try to trick us to seeing a curve because they use a fisheye lens to film different events. And that Red Bull jump, I don't remember the gentleman's name who jumped, but when he was inside his high altitude plane, the interior shot showed a flat horizon. But the minute he stepped outside, they started using, in getting ready to jump, they started using a fisheye lens, which made the Earth look curved. And that's the image that people were looking at. And I even remember seeing people who don't believe in flat Earth using that, sending that to me, like, what do you think now? Look right there, the curve of the Earth. So it's, you know, we're being tricked on many different levels when it comes to the shape of the Earth.
Yeah.
Interesting. Absolutely. I gotta ask you to explain this one though to me. I've traveled to Alaska a number of times. I used to do a lot of work and fishing up there. We would take off from Salt Lake City on Alaskan Airlines. We'd fly. We'd leave about 6:30, 7 o'clock in the afternoon evening. This as the sun is going down, as we're flying due north, a strange anomaly happened a number of times. I witnessed this, how you watch the sun setting. You're basically chasing the sun, right?
Yeah.
And it doesn't really get dark because suddenly you're on the left-hand side of the plane, right, the western side of the plane as you're going north, and then the sun just comes up on the east. It's like, okay, it sets a little bit on the west, it comes up on the east, and when you're up in the land of the midnight sun in July, you don't have much darkness anyway. Explain how that fits into the flat Earth paradigm versus the globe, because the globe makes more sense that it would, you know, further north you go, the sun would set and rise faster.
It makes more sense if you're following the globe model, sure. But on a flat model, the sun and the moon actually work quite well. In my opinion, they work way more efficiently. And that is, a lot of people are going to ask, it's like, okay, because that's one of the first questions that gets thrown there. What is the sun? What is the moon? What are the stars? Let me do the easy one first. And that is, the stars and the planets that you see there are no different than a giant Truman Show type planetarium. They are very well rendered images. They are not millions of light years or light years, or even, they're probably not even thousands of miles away. They're right there. They're part of the projection system. But the sun and the moon, they are three-dimensional objects, in my opinion. One is an incandescent light. One is the equivalent of a cool laser. And I know we don't have time to go into all of this, but if you, the easiest way to explain it is if you take a flat Earth map and you take the yin-yang symbol and you smack it right on top of it. One shows the path of the sun, one shows the path of the moon. Those paths do not stay static. They are dynamic. So, like a needle on a record player, the sun goes around and changes its path in accordance with the seasons. The same with the moon. Does the moon have anything to do with the tides? No. People say, well, what's the blood moon? The blood moon has to be artificial because there is no Earth between the sun and the moon. The sun gives off I'll throw a couple more. And unfortunately, I'm going to be kind of scattered when I say this. The sun is an incandescent system. Yes, it gives off warmth. Does it affect all the seasons? Does it control the seasons? No. There's plenty of other systems that do that. And by that, I mean the jet stream, which is upper, the underwater conveyor system, which is in the oceans, the magma system, which is under that. The moon, however, fascinating. That object has got some really neat stuff that's happening. If anyone wants to look some of that stuff up, look up lunar waves on YouTube. It's done by a guy that I interviewed fairly recently, which was his name's Crow777, CROW777. And what he did was, and when I talked about the detection technology, was that he took an HD camera, attached it to a telescope, and started shooting the moon. And he is now noticing resolution issues, basically a refresh issue with the moon. That's not possible unless the moon, the image of the moon, there's something there that is being projected on top of the moon's surface. We don't know what that is. Plus, I'll throw one more in at you. The moonlight test, which we've been doing recently, that's amazing. How we missed that for so long, which is moonlight is a cooling light. And I don't mean it's cooler than the sun. I mean that the moon may be completely self-illuminated entirely because the light it gives off is like a refrigeration light. Meaning if you're in the sun, say it's 100 degrees in the sun, but it's 90 degrees in the shade. We all get that. It's cooler in the shade. But if you're in moonlight, it's warmer in the shade. So you put an object out in the moonlight, and let's say it's 20 degrees in the shade, it'll actually be 17 degrees in the moonlight. And so there have been people who have gone out to test just a few months ago where they take a magnifying glass, they hold it up to the moon because, okay, if you're magnifying cool light, does it get warmer or does it get colder? And it actually gets colder. You can actually magnify this light. And the only way we can do that is with technology. It's called a cold laser. It's fascinating. There's so many different aspects of this, which we're still just trying to dissect.
Well, you know, I love astronomy. Looking at it, not astrology, astronomy. Here in Ogden, there's an Ott planetarium, for heaven's sakes, built by my uncle. Donated a lot of some money to build this planetarium, this big huge telescope observatory. So I know a little bit about it. I like looking at the moon through a really high-powered telescope, and it's amazing that the surface of the moon is so diverse. It really is. And yet you talk about, well, there's a dark side of the moon, right? You never see the other side of the moon. It's supposed to be a globe too, right? Wow. What causes then the different phases of the moon if it's not the Earth's shadow?
Yeah.
How do you explain that?
Oh, it's artificial. It's absolutely a fabrication. It'd be no different. What I try to tell people, and we do this in entertainment technology and computer technology all the time now, and that is, if I wanted to put, say, Patricia's face on the moon, I could do it in a simulation. If I wanted to make the sun do figure eights, I could do it. If I wanted to make the stars spell out my name, I could do it. So we just have to expand our imagination to the point where it's like, okay, which is why I keep using the Truman Show as a reference. The Truman Show was only a structure maybe less than 20 miles wide, but it encapsulated everything, including the sun, moon, and stars and all that. If you could build a structure that was, say, 5,000 miles wide, what couldn't you do up there? And of course, the moon, every phase of the moon would have to be artificial, not just the blood moon, but the crescents as well. Everything would have to be artificial when it comes to that thing. But because we've been told what it is for so long, since we were children, the conditioning has sunk in to where it's really difficult for us to break out of it. Only now in 2015, and I do not know why this year has made it so different than last year or the year before. But now it seems that we're slowly but surely reaching some sort of 100th monkey effect where people are snapping out of it. And once they break out of the illusion, you can't go back. That's the great thing about flat Earth. Once you reach that critical mass, you can't get it and then go back to the globe. It just doesn't work like that.
Well, you know, there's been renditioning of the moon phases you know, for thousands of years. So it's not just a modern type of anomaly.
No.
So,
no, it's built by the system. I mean, the people that built this, or the creator, or the architects, whatever you want to call them, that is part. It is their system. The only conspiracy part about this is that humankind, our civilization, discovered it only about 60 years ago and decided, well, you know what, let's just keep it a secret. We had nothing to do with any aspect of this. All we're doing, and by that I mean the authority, meaning the governments, the super rich and the royals, they decide, you know what, the power structure, we like it the way it is, let's just hold on to it. But as of now, every day it's growing stronger and more people are getting it. I get less and less hate mail, to the point where I firmly believe this thing's gonna break wide open eventually.
Well, Sean, I gotta tell you, I need to spend a lot more time on your website, Mark, and same with you, Patricia. Why don't you just go ahead and give out your website information, if you would, Patricia. How can people contact you or talk to you more if you want to have more information?
Well, I have a YouTube channel, and it's called Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and a Facebook page by the same name. So you can just go to YouTube and type in Patricia Steer or Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and I'll be right there. And all of my videos are there. I do several each week, and they all are about the Flat Earth and other hot potatoes, but generally about the Flat Earth. So by contacting me, it can be done through the YouTube channel page.
Okay, cool. Great. Thanks, Mark.
I am – the easiest way to look find my stuff is probably going to be through YouTube as well. I have a YouTube channel called Mark K. Sargent. But honestly, the best way to find my stuff is just Google or use whatever browser, search engine you want, and type in Flat Earth Clues, because that's the big stuff that I made was Flat Earth Clues. Or you could go to my main webpage, which is enclosedworld.com. Either way, you'll get there. I don't have a Facebook page or a Twitter account or anything like that. I'm trying to keep I don't want to stretch myself too thin because there's so much media I have to keep. I can't even read all the emails and phone calls I get now. But that is the easiest way to get a hold of me. And my phone number and my emails at the end of every video I put out there, including my home address. So send cookies to that.
Okay, very good. In preparing for the show tonight, of course, looked through all of both of your websites, and didn't have the time to go through all of the channels that you've done the films. But listen, I was amazed to read the Wikipedia entry on Flat Earth Society, and dating back to the 16th, the 15th century, these societies have been promulgated by some of the deepest thinkers in the world. Really, I mean, it's just not some wild lunacy crackpots that are doing this. If you go back and just follow the footnotes, as I did with the Wikipedia entry, there's substance there.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been around. It's weird because people are latching onto it now, and I get this more often than not, which is they say, oh, it's this new thing. It's this new hot conspiracy I'm going to be talking about. It's the oldest conspiracy there is. It's the oldest concept there is. In fact, it's something we're actually having to relearn, because for the first, if our civilization's only been around, without broken history for like 5,000 years, the first 4,500 of it, that's what we thought. Every religion, every tribe, every culture, they all bought into it, from the Christian religion with the firmament to the tribal religions. So they say the canopy of stars and where the sun came from, where the moon came from, but it was all an enclosed system. And it's really, really exciting. I could not be more thrilled, because I still think it gives us hope as a civilization. If this thing comes out, I think it makes us one big family, one big community, a village, as it were, to where we are accountable for our actions. And I think that is what will help us move forward into whatever new age we create.
Mm-hmm. Well, I could also say that when I was, this has been many years ago, I was looking over, I was doing some cartology work, studying ancient maps. In fact, my my good friend who started the story behind the story with me, Warren Anderson, was a dealer in really old documents and especially old maps. He loved to find them. He had an old map. I think it was, if I remember correctly, it was Persian, because you know the ancient, you know, Persia, which is modern day Iran. I mean, you're talking about some of the really gifted astronomers back then, the magi of Christ's time. These were Persian kings that had studied, you know, this whole system. And what was stunning about every ancient Persian map, and we're talking, when I talk about ancient, we're talking about 1st, 2nd, 3rd century modern era, right? And even up until fairly recently, you know, 1600s, right? They all showed basically the same thing as you see in the United Nations map. Yes. A centrally flat land with a border, a map around it, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they all agreed. And you'd think that, you know, varying religions would have different maps, and they didn't. They all, how did that happen? You know, how did all of a sudden, and I think actually it was part of the system that we were in. I think at one point the globe concept was artificially introduced, and I think the people that built this had a hand in it, because, and I talked about it in the clues, and that is human beings have a really, really hard time with confinement of any kind. It doesn't matter if it's a very, very comfortable, well-designed confinement. And so the globe model was introduced, and then it caught on. And with some fancy numbers, I mean, it's a huge, I'm amazed there wasn't much pushback when the globe concept came out, to be honest, because the other map was so easy. It wasn't spinning, you know, it was a static map with an enclosure, it was a piece of cake. And, you know, Copernicus and the other people said, oh no, well, if it's a globe and it's spinning at 1,000 miles an hour and it's spinning around the sun at 60,000 miles an hour, oh yeah, and that solar system is also spinning through space, all this motion, all these forces of physics, then it works. I would have thought that there would have been more pushback for that, and there wasn't. It was embraced, and the church figured out, it's like, you know what, let's not fight it. Let's be progressive, and we'll keep this in our back pocket, and maybe one day we'll be able to use it again. And I think it's also, I think, why the church has latched onto it now. We have a lot of religious, deeply religious people involved in the Flat Earth movement right now, which is amazing to see.
That's interesting to say that, too, because, you know, you look back at Copernicus, for an example. I mean, when they came out with these different concepts, they were called heretics. I mean, it was a spiritual problem to them, to the church body. And I'm not saying the Roman Church is anything to, you know, to hold a candle to. But you're talking even Orthodox Greek and others. It was absolutely heresy. It was a false teaching back then to talk about a globe.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. But for some reason, it took. And again, you know, if it's artificial, maybe in the same reason why it's now seems to be reversing. You know, maybe it's all part of the plan, because I couldn't see any reason for it to really, you know, because people don't like harder stuff. You know, they don't like advanced concepts. If something, the reason why things catch on is because it's easy and it's simple and it's convenient. But that was none of those things back then. So maybe now that's why it's taking off, because it's so, you know, people that didn't like dealing with calculus or trigonometry or quantum physics or any of that, maybe now they see this and it's like, you know what, this makes life easier. It does. People get it. They absolutely get it. It takes a little while to give up. In fact, the only fighting I see, and I think I can speak for Patricia as well, is that the people have a hard time giving up the old ways. They don't want to give up the moon. They don't want to give up NASA.
They don't want to give up sci-fi. Sci-fi is a big one. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Science fiction takes a big hit in this case. In fact, I had a guy say, look, I have a hard time watching Star Trek now. And I said, look, don't give that up. And people at sci-fi franchises out there are probably going, oh, geez, we got to stomp on this flat Earth thing. But no, it doesn't mean that sci-fi isn't eradicated. It's just you can't use it in reference to the Earth that we're on. You could still believe in Star Trek, but you can't, you know, you can't really tie it to Earth anymore. So, yeah, you're going to lose part of it. No,
it's,
no
it's,
Exploring where no man has gone before and never will go is probably
there
the
you
new
go.
Star Trek signature they should use.
Nice.
Well, you know, I'm a huge fan of Nikola Tesla. I've got papers and books and studied a lot of his patents. And, you know, he didn't come out and actually make public statements. But part of the friction, I think, between him and Edison was, you know, because Tesla was talking about, again, linear trajectories. And basically, you know, he was espousing that energy fields travel on a linear, not a global arc. And as you look into what he was proposing as far as his worldview, his paradigm, I think he would be on board with this.
Yeah. I think eventually mainstream science is going to have a problem, no question. Anyone with a PhD in astronomy, astrophysics, they're in trouble. Because they've spent so well, you would know. I mean, anyone that spent that much education concentrated on one subject, and to have it completely reversed, yeah, they're gonna have a hard time. But the other scientists, they're gonna also have a hard time too, because no one wants, you know, it's a club like anything. They don't want, if you come out the first scientist, that's really gonna be the groundbreaker. Is the first scientist that comes out and says, you know what, the flat earthers may have something here. Because you can't. There's too many really large questions. Granted, that aren't math based. There are some that are. There's too many large questions which they won't touch, because they can't. The biggest for me, which is, you know, one I actually put forward to a friend of mine, because he wanted to ask a scientist something. He goes, if I ask him one question, what would you ask him? I say, fine. Talk about how we got past the Van Allen radiation belts that were announced in 1959. Van Allen radiation belts announced by NASA, I think probably premature. They said it's the deadliest thing to human beings. Human beings cannot get past them without dying. But yet, Apollo 8 through Apollo 17 made round trips through them. Nobody died. Nobody got cancer. The capsules weren't contaminated. And they didn't use any shielding. And the only shielding, the reason why it was such a bad idea in 1959, but they didn't know it, because we didn't know anything about radiation. And the only two metals that are really used to protect from radiation are either lead, which we still use today on dentist chairs, or gold, which is twice as dense as lead, or almost twice as dense. And either way, you can't put something that heavy on top of a capsule. You can't fly an anchor. So how did we get through the Van Allen radiation belts? And then they might come back and say, it's a trick question. It's a trap. And the question, because they'll say, well, the Van Allen, because now there's articles saying, well, you know, the Van Allen belts aren't that bad. I say, really? Because the Orion project, which is going on right now in 2015, which is a manned capsule, they won't send men up into it because they say, well, we still got to deal with the radiation problem. I'm going, well, and they do this on video. This isn't like an article. They actually have a video production on this. I'm going, well, what are you talking about? Dealing with the radiation problem. You dealt with it back in the 60s. What changed? Did you forget how to deal with radiation? We have advanced technology. There's no alloy that you've invented. At least make up something. It's the lack of cover stories just infuriates me. It's just bad writing on my part, or I'm sorry, on their part.
Interesting.
Mark, I would like to answer a question that keeps popping up in that area, and that's the question: since assuming the Earth is flat and there's no outer space, are there satellites out there? What's happening with those all the satellite dishes where we are supposed to be receiving signals from a geostationary satellite, which is whatever 30,000 miles out there? It's very simple. If you take a perspective like the one you show on the front page of your website, enclosedworld.com, assuming there's a big sphere around us, whether it's smaller or much bigger, it doesn't really matter. If you take a big dish, one of those huge 100-foot dishes, and you point it up to the canopy, let's say to that ceiling, to that canopy, it will reflect, the microwave signal will reflect down. according to the angle of whatever you send up. So yeah. You can point dishes to the point of where the signal is reflected, and you will receive signal. So it's not necessary for satellites to be out there to receive satellite TV. It could all be terrestrial, reflecting on the dome itself.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And the satellites, for me, I have little or no faith in them anymore because several reasons. One would be the ISS, the International Space Station. The interior footage of that that has been shot over the last few years and released to the public is abysmal from a production standpoint. The effects are shabby. The writing is terrible. The whole production is just a mess. So if that is being faked, then how can I have any faith in satellites at all? But yeah, you're absolutely right. Also, they could compensate with the existing LORAN system, which I don't think was ever shut down, LORAN. They could compensate with new towers. They could compensate with anything. Yes. Do people's home dishes point at something? Yes. Do I think they're satellites? No, I don't. And again, we don't have time to get into it all. You'll just have to go through the site and all the content out there and take a look for yourself.
Mm-hmm. I have to bring in something else that I made a note here on. I did a show a few months back on the it's one of these other hugely censored stories of this great, huge Grand Canyon Egyptian city. Now, talking to people that have explained what they've seen in the Smithsonian concerning the artifacts coming out of the Grand Canyon, this is another huge part of the puzzle, I think, because we're talking about, pictures that were sent to me, and I've sent them out to some people. Say, well, that could be easily photoshopped, yada yada. But it's not. They're talking about, again, maps that were written on papyrus. That again shows this exact same thing we're talking about here, folks. This Egyptian culture. What in the world is an Egyptian city doing in the Grand Canyon? And look, there's places in the Grand Canyon National Park area that are flat out, just like the Antarctica region, you will not be allowed to go in there. They tell you, and I've been down there many times and asked to go into these places. No, there's too many unsafe caves, they say. It's too dangerous, et cetera, et cetera. What don't they want us to know? What are they keeping from us? And I guarantee you that's a huge part of this cover-up story.
Yeah, agreed. What I've tried to tell people beforehand, because what you're talking about is the previous tenants of this place. Because in a structure like this, we're not the first renters of this apartment by any stretch. There have been previous civilizations, and they had advanced technology. In fact, in several cases, probably more than ours. But we're not allowed to know about that. That is also hidden. How many underwater cities do we have to know about? How about the radioactive glass down in India? The entire text of the Mahabharata. It just goes on and on of the ancient ruins that are all over the place, plus the carbon dating system that can't be trusted. We're yep. arrogant in that aspect. Our history goes back 5,000 years, and that's it. That's all. That's it. There was no other civilizations before us. That is so unbelievably arrogant.
Truly. Mark, we have a caller that's been on the line added from 818 area code, wants to weigh in on this discussion. Welcome to the show, caller. Question or comment?
I think we're standing by to have that caller reconnected if possible. Oh, no, the caller dropped off the line.
Dropped off. Okay, not a problem. Well, yeah, this I'm sure we're going to get I'm going to get an earful from people, I'm sure. But again, let's debate it logically. Let's not sit out there and just cast stones. You're not supposed to be talking about this. You're losing your mind. That happens so often with so many different topics. And the information, ladies and gentlemen, is credible if you really, again, put your biases, your prejudices aside and just have an open mind and think. Ask questions, okay? Find if it fits or not. But Mark, Patricia, we got about 5 minutes left, really. Wrap up. What would you like to, where do you see this thing heading? in the next year or 2 years from your standpoint?
I'm thinking within 2 years, it's going to be broke wide open. I don't know exactly what is going to be the key that goes into the right lock at the right time that springs it open, but something's going to happen. Lots of little things are happening all of the time when it comes to flat Earth moving forward and more people learning about it and knowing about it and accepting it. But there's going to be some kind of an event, or it could be as simple as a famous person coming out and talking about flat Earth openly. A scientist, as Mark said earlier, coming out and, you know, not really caring about their career as much. I mean, somebody really big, and just exposing what they know. I'm not sure, Mark, what do you think could be the thing that we're looking for?
Well, that's just it. I mean, right now it appears to be smoldering and sometimes burning under the surface, because it's a secret conspiracy. And by that I mean it's the conspiracy that the cool kids talk about, but they don't talk about it openly. It's one of those things where people, it's like, yeah, you know, they talk about 9/11 or Sandy Hook or Boston Bomb or whatever you want to talk about. It's like, yeah, but you've seen this one? Flat Earth, man. You got to check that out. It's Flat Earth. And it's people, I wasn't kidding when I said it's kind of like Fight Club, where the first rule is you don't talk about it, but you whisper it to your best friends and say, what do you think, man? What do you think? That's what I keep seeing more and more. So it seems to be seeping in around the edges, and the mainstream media can't dare touch it unless they have some sort of game plan. So yeah, what Patricia was saying, is it going to be a celebrity coming forward, a scientist, a radio telescope operator, somewhere along those lines? It better be, because the people I've had recently were the last five in the last, month and a half. I had United States Navy missile instructor, a submarine chief, a career surveyor, a industrial engineer, and a flight instructor. They all said the same thing. Nothing contradicted each other. None of them even disagree with each other at any points. They all said, yeah, we've heard about the curve. We don't use it. Nobody uses it anywhere. It's a myth. It's just something that you see on mainstream every once in a while, and it's reinforced, but it doesn't exist.
Interesting. Huh? Yeah, that's, you know, the preponderance of evidence kind of shows there's something very, very different there than what you've been led to believe. And yeah, it's like everybody else, I've had to kind of do the same thing. Put your biases, what you've been programmed to believe is true, put it aside and just say what really is. And then you start to say there's clues. You've done a great job. I've just looked at a few. Mark, I'll dig into it a lot more. I thank you for your work and the effort you put into it.
And
same to you, Patricia. What a strange world we live in. I just keep going back to that 1991 interview that I had, and he kept referring to the edge of the earth, you know, the outer limits, things like that, colloquialisms. But he says that's literally the way it is.
Well, right. There's movies like Capricorn One that you can just go, download and watch. Came out in the 70s, O.J. Simpson in it and a host of other stars that are about a mission to Mars that had to be faked. But yeah, it's pretty much the story of what went on with the Apollo missions. Yeah. So it's 1977, that movie?
Roughly, Yeah, and let me throw in one more, and that is, look, for those people out there, because this hits people like a truck, and that is, you're not going to get this right away. Nobody, I mean, yeah, every once in a while, there's somebody gets this right away. But most of you, it's going to take days. But it is going to be, and I like the analogy I came up with recently, and it's going to be like a marble in a paint can. It's going to be rattling around your head until you resolve it one way or the other. You're either going to dismiss it entirely and say, you know what, I'm never going to look at it again, or you're going to research it yourself. And days from now, maybe weeks from now, you're going to sit down, you're going to go, you know what, I can't prove it's a globe anymore. I can't prove my world anymore. And that's when it changes, and that's when it starts getting interesting.
Again, just look at the Bible quote in Genesis, where, you know, the firmament was set in the heavens. The word firmament in the original Hebrew is basically has to do with the dome structure. That's what it means.
Yeah.
So
yeah. And that word you said there, why would the creator of NASA put that on his headstone if not to leave a breadcrumb trail? Why would he put a Bible verse that mentions the firmament on his headstone? You know, Wernher von Braun, look it up. It's right there. You can Google it anytime.
And what were the Nazis doing in Antarctica? You know, why Operation High Jump? These are all, I mean, these are really important questions. Do they matter? Well, it matters. I mean, that's a huge expedition. You know, it's just only second only in size to the D-Day Normandy invasion, for heaven's sakes. And the tragedy is, Mark and Patricia, 99 out of 100 people haven't got a clue about that.
Well, we're trying to change that. We are trying to change it every single day in every single way.
Okay, my gullies. 2 minutes left on the show. Final, you know, final statements, Patricia?
Well, I'm just going to say, check out Mark Sargent's Flat Earth Clues. You can find it on YouTube. I'm just going to promote Mark. Maybe he'll promote me afterwards. Oh. We'll just see. We'll see about that in a minute. Okay. Also, Strange World, you can find that on YouTube. And enclosedworld.com, that's his website. And there's so much good information there. And once you find those videos, there'll be suggested videos that you can watch. And it'll just send you on this, not a wild goose chase. No, it'll send you down what they say the rabbit hole is. Just, it almost never ends. And as far as I know, it might end at Flat Earth, but there's probably something else, something yet we haven't yet discovered, something even bigger as to what's really going on here. So this is only the beginning.
Agreed. I couldn't have said better myself. And I am going to promote Patricia's YouTube channel, which is Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. And since she's come on the scene, she has interviewed a lot of people. The majority of the people that have been in the Flat Earth movement that have been making and shaking and creating some fantastic videos. And she tends to scoop me more than other people.
Well, great show, folks. Mark, Sarge.